This is the College of Complexes, and we need a little quiet in here so that we can hear ourselves think. And I will speak into the microphone. We have two rules here at the college, and the first one is one fool at a time, the rest of you is be quiet. And the other rule is that we do not insult anybody here or their parents. Okay? That's our two basic rules. Otherwise, we have an agenda which begins. Where is our speaker?
He's here. He's ready.
I wanted to say hiding in the back, modestly. All right, Mr. Sven, you're on. The 21st century is all new cosmology, the Big Bang, how, where, and when, and you're on.
Thank you very much.
Hampered is no salt.
Good evening.
Who's the microphone?
My name is Charles Sven. I've been studying the universe for 18 years. I got started by seeing an article in the Chicago Tribune talking about gamma ray bursts. And so that fascinated me, and I wanted to find out more about it. And so what I needed to do was get more information.
I owe you. Can you?
Yes, it's working. So, in order to get all we could find was a lot of old stuff very easy, and I needed some new stuff. So I got rid of a lot of things that people talk about and found NASA and equivalent sources on the web. This provided the background that I used for creating my study of universe. Universe, as we are aware, is composed of a lot of parts. And I'm going to show you how to unravel all those parts this evening. Hopefully, I put some things in here that makes this a little bit easier, lighter to follow. I finished my 18 years of study. I created a book, the Big Bang book. How, where, and when demonstrated. It's available for sale here. It's $9.95 with tax, $10.
Whoa.
So, today we talk about the Big Bang explodes in space. And it was a lot easier to keep an eye on things before the Big Bang. Everything was all in one place then. But I put it in the book with all the pieces. So the first thing we're talking about is how did the Big Bang take place? There's been a lot of mathematicians working on that starting in about 100 years ago. Cosmologists have been trying to figure out creation using math. Well, cosmology, the study of the universe, which is currently relying on old math formulas. Tim, can I ask you
a... I'm shutting mine down.
Okay. Okay.
That's all. Just shutting it down.
No problem. Cosmology relies on old math formulas, trying to without solving really how the Big Bang worked until my work put together in this book. The mathematical foundation of modern cosmology starts with relativity from Einstein, expanding space by de Sitter. We got the singularity produced by Lamette, creation from nothing by Alexander Friedman, and Milne says the universe has no center. All these are reworking of Einstein's relativity. Fortunately, we have an eminent physicist, Richard Feynman, and he says, unfortunately he passed away, he says mathematics is not physics, and physics is not mathematics. So, first thing we need to do is replace math with physics. So, hey Jeffrey, what are you doing out here? I'm working on a physics problem using math. Looks like you're having a nap.
Well, he says the creative process works best with a relaxed brain. So I'm letting my mind wander to let a solution drift in. Hey, cool. Can I help? Well, it's a space-time quandary of relativity and blah, 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 blah. She falls asleep. You're not helping. Well, trying to figure out physics with math can put anybody to sleep. So what is that singularity? A dot from where our universe came from, out of nowhere. And that was using the math formula of Lamet. He was the first one to come up with that. And he says that if our universe began with a single quantum, that singularity, then the time and space began a little bit before then. If he published this in Nature magazine in 1931. So we need to change that if to reality. Looking at that magnificent display of stars sure makes you stop and think, doesn't it? Hagar says. I started to think, but nothing happened, said his sidekick.
Just like you guys.
That's what cosmology is like. So what does cosmology know about the Big Bang? They have all this old information that they're using, the mathematics, and from Harvard Smithsonian Center for Astrophysics, they print on their website, no one knows yet what happened at the instant of the Big Bang or what came before. Most cosmologists believe that our universe, and with it space and time, exploded from being into nothing, exploded into being from nothing. New York Times reported before the Big Bang, there was what? Nothing. So here we have the universe created from nothing, just like this depiction of one hand painting the other, an impossibility. So we need to focus on something that's similar to that singularity, and I picked the atom as a place to start, and I found an awful lot of great information. So going to the atom lab, your friend Max says, okay, Eugene, when were the atoms made? This is a simple question. Most people don't really think much about it. We have in Japan, underneath the mountain, this super cameo candy, a 50,000 tank of water, of ultra pure water, lined with sensors, trying to find out if any atoms break down. And they haven't found any protons breaking down. So the estimated minimum age of the atom is far greater than the age of our 13 billion year old universe. So all the atoms were created in the Big Bang. So, how did the Big Bang bang? How did our universe begin? To solve that question, we need to bring a lot of stuff together. And that's what I have assembled in my book. We've got atoms, protons, electrons, photons, dark energy, and space among some of the elements that are put together in a new format that allows us to see how the universe started.
Okay.
So one of the first things I found that pertains to our study of the universe that's really interesting was reported in Scientific America in the 96. It shows a depiction of the atom taken from an electric microscope. And as you see in Scientific America, we see the atom looking like a ball bearing with a blue center. And further, other sites show a layer of atoms looking like a layer of ball bearings. You can find them on various sites. I also have the link available in my book. They all look like ball bearings. So why does an atom look like a ball bearing? One of the most interesting things that we can all do is get out a box of matches, go into our kitchen, turn out the lights, strike a match, and we have light photons exiting that atom at 186,000 miles per second. Yes. So in order for that light photon to be moving at 186,000 miles per second, we have to have something that will, like hitting a ball with a bat, as fast as that bat is moving, that's how fast that ball will move. So we have the electron moving in the atom at 186,000 miles per second. And these lines of magnetic-like forces that fill the atom drive those electrons around at light speed continually since the Big Bang some 13 billion years ago, at least 13 billion years ago. So, if we look at the atom, the electron moving at 186,000 miles per second, if we divide that by the circumference of the atom, which is very tiny, the answer is that the electron travels at approximately a million trillion orbits per second. And we don't have a 13 billion-year-old battery in that atom. So what we want to know is how much power does that 13 billion-year-old atom need? Now, a battery might last maybe 10 minutes, not a day, driving electrons at light speed, but definitely not for 13 billion years. So we need an external source of energy, and we find that in 1831, Michael Faraday, and later Nikola Tesla, began demonstrating wireless power transmissions. And today you could find some cell phones and laptops that can be charged on a pad without any wiring. Further, we do know that we have energy transmission by radio waves, and we have TV waves transmitted power without any wiring. So charging this battery is probably dark energy, just possibly the most important problem in all of physics. And cosmologist Michael Turner at the University of Chicago coined this term in 1998. I can't put a meter on an atom. But just because I can't put a meter on an atom doesn't mean I can't infer how much power that atom takes. So now, interestingly enough, the scientists who have studied the atomic bomb found that only a very few number of uranium atoms were used in destroying Hiroshima. The number of atoms used were equivalent to the atoms in 1/4 of a dime. So just that little bit destroyed Hiroshima. And what happened was is we actually converted matter or redirected the energy feeding that atom and exploded it out, destroying Hiroshima. And that's the same power that fuels all the stars. So the atom's power supply, huge amounts of dark energy. I'm sorry, I'm trying to read that. Huge amounts of dark energy directed,
reflected
to the compression of 235 atoms, destroying Hiroshima. The same process powers all the stars, and dark energy must permeate all of space now and prior to the Big Bang, to the Big Bang's explosive conversion of energy into matter. And interestingly, at Stanford Labs, we did the reverse of the atomic bomb. we at Stanford Labs, they smashed a huge energy laser and an energy beam that was 10,000 times larger than an energy laser. They smashed them together and they created two tiny bits of matter, the opposite of what we did at the atomic bomb. And according to NASA, NASA believes, without any proof, that our universe, 70% of our universe is made of dark energy. So dark energy in atoms existed prior to the Big Bang. Converging dark energy created the atoms, just like at Stanford. Electrons travel at light speed. Dark energy drives atoms, electrons. We only use a very few number of U-235 atoms to destroy Hiroshima. Dark energy was redirected in those atoms to destroy Hiroshima, and Stanford Labs created matter from energy. And this is the same process that fuels our stars. So what we have is before the Big Bang, we have space, time and space filled with dark energy. That sufficient amount of dark energy converged into a small enough space, setting off the Big Bang, just like they did at Stanford. And that's where we put it all together, saying the same thing. Turbulent dark energy running all kinds of patterns, filling all the space, that continually keeps atoms from collapsing, that pushes electrons, driving light photons, and is released in star chain reactions, finds that before a universe was formed, it ran every pattern until a sufficient amount converged into a small enough space that set off the conversion of dark energy into matter, just like at Stanford.
You didn't have three
vision? This was the end of chapter one in my book. We got more to go. If you have any questions, I'll be more than happy to entertain them.
Well, after your lecture, we'll...
Oh, I'm so sorry.
Right there. All I can do is show how it works. Just like we can't define light photons anymore or electricity anymore, we can show how it works. How about magnetism? Very interesting. We show how it works. Gravity? We don't know what gravity is, but we show how it works. Yes, in the back.
Same question was for dark energy. I guess you can't define that either, right?
That's what there is most of the phenomena of our world, we can show how it works, but we don't know what energy is. Right, we don't know what fire is. All these things are, we use them all the time, and we think we know what it is, but we all can do is find. Yes?
We have to make this.
No, I have a man in the back, please.
Isn't cosmology something that you get at a beauty parlor?
Oh.
Okay.
Do I have to answer that?
Yes.
Yeah.
No, don't answer.
That's silly.
Yes.
Can you speak up?
Identify the Big Bang with the first few verses of Genesis.
I think they did a good job. They did a wonderful job. They said the universe started out of chaos. And chaos is another word for dark energy.
Right, Dean. Yeah, is there any indication in the past history that the speed of light or any other constants that we deal with could have been a different speed, different number?
I used to be a teacher, and I just loved when kids asked these what-if questions. You know, there's about 10 zillion what-if questions to one what is. I only try to deal with things that I could replicate, like striking a match, like dropping the atomic bomb, like stars being converting their hydrogen into light. Those things I could talk about. But what is? I don't. Right.
All right. I'd like to know your views on, now that you've defined the Big Bang, dark energy, the atoms and how they work. I'd like to know what you would think about how we can harness this as a power source and cure global warming.
Strike a match.
I deal with things that I can replicate.
Okay, fair enough.
Yes, in the back.
Hey, is the universe still expanding?
Well, that's part of my one of the later chapters that I can get to it in here later on. I'll answer that.
Doug, good share.
Yes, you seem to have a very technical presentation, but we have nothing on your background. You just said you were a teacher, or a teacher of what, and what is your level of expertise?
Do you have a problem?
How many degree, huh?
Yeah. Do you have a problem with when I strike a match, the light exits at 186,000 miles per second?
No, I want to know, what is your field of expertise?
We'd just like to know a little bit about you.
I've been studying the universe for 18 years, and I pursued every bit of experimental material that's been presented in relation to cosmology.
So were you a teacher of science when you taught?
No, math.
Oh, okay, thank you.
Charles.
Yeah, page 33 of your book, Charles, it states that atoms are orbiting, or electrons are orbiting at a million trillion orbits per second.
Yeah.
Who ascertained that, and how did they measure it?
Okay, we take when I strike a match, I have light photons exiting at 186,000 miles per second. And when I divide that by the tiny circumference of an atom, I'll get approximately 100 million orbits per second. Now, there's no question that some atoms are larger than others, and I said approximately. So give or take 100,000. Trillion orbits, you know, give or take 100,000.
Just one follow-up. I'm used to a lot of figures in astrophysics, but a million trillion is kind of high, would you say?
Yes, I think the atom is amazing.
It has to be the highest number in any...
All right, Sid Cohen, Jan Bodart, and
that okay, do you think chaos or order is the most important?
Yes.
No, explain it to you.
Yes.
That's not explaining anything.
I don't think anyone else can either.
Tough luck, sir.
Tough luck, sir.
Sorry. Yes.
I wonder when you made that calculation about the amount of
orbits
of the electron, if you took into account the difference in mass between a photon and an electron.
Yeah, the photon has no mass.
Yeah, so.
But what we do know is that when I strike a match, light photons are moving at 186,000 miles per second.
And so in one second,
a light photon moves at 186,000 miles. And what drives that is if I hit or I activate the light photon with an electron, that must mean the electron in the atom is moving at 186,000 miles per second. And when I divide that by the very tiny circumference of the atom, I get a million trillion orbits per second.
All right, Doug Beckley. And are you aware of the actual explanation in quantum mechanics of the emission of the photon from an atom is due to the electron traveling between energy levels, and that
can you tell me
how describe
quantum mechanics
as orbiting?
Right.
We are using orbitals, which are functions that come out of the Schrödinger equation.
Yeah, equations are wonderful, but physics is not math, and math is not physics. And when I strike a match, I get light photons going at 186,000 miles per second. And you're going to tell me you're going to have a change in energy that's moving at 186,000 miles per second.
Change in energy creates a photon with the energy of the difference of the energy levels in the atom.
The difference of the energy levels is it has to drive a photon at 186,000 miles per second.
Right, that's the speed of the photon, but that has nothing to do with the actual amount of energy released.
Wonderful.
Daniela.
Yeah, I became really interested at some point about the emergent order from chaos, and I came across kinematics, as kinematic science, C-Y-M-A.
I'm not familiar with it.
It's like that experiment where you take a speaker and you put a metal plate on it and throw, and you play something, you throw salt on it, and depending on the pitch, the salt will order itself out of chaos into very distinct patterns.
That's
if
nice.
You move the pitch up, it continues to do that to a higher order.
Right, so you're having physical effects and supposedly some other unknown effects working together. I'm saying that the dark energy before the Big Bang filled all of time and space, and that it ran all kinds of turbulent patterns until finally a sufficient amount of that dark energy converged into a small enough area that set off the conversion of energy into matter, which is the same thing that they did at Stanford, although a much smaller scale. There's somebody in the back who's been trying to get a question
in.
Yes,
Mike Lee.
Okay.
I got two parts. What did things look like 13 billion and 1 year ago before the Big Bang, and then physically? And then two, the Republicans really love fairy tales and the evolution, and not evolution, but creation. You have ways to dispel creation.
Well, that's what this whole first chapter is about, is trying to describe how the atom works and the power related to the atom and where does that power source come from. And so we have the light photons coming from a match, we have a few atoms destroying Hiroshima, and we have the atom power powering the stars. And that same power is continually working today, because take out a match, anybody, and strike it, and believe it or not, your light will come out at 186,000 miles per second at any time.
But what exploded during the
See, there it is. So what we're saying is that
dark energy
is driving the electron in the atom.
Dark energy. Converted in the atom.
And it's driving everything right now. And there's so much dark energy fueling the atoms in your body, in my body, and that piece of granite outside, and the mountains, and all the stars. Yes?
I read several science journals. Scientists are not sure what dark energy is.
That's right. Just like we don't know what energy, what the fire is, magnetism, gravity, energy. All these things are things that we describe, but we don't know what they are.
I would just like to know why you pursued writing this book. What was the motive for pursuing it? I just, every writer who does something usually does it for some kind of a reason. And would you mind just telling me a little bit about the background of the book and how it, quote unquote, evolved?
Well, I started by saying I saw something in one of the newspaper articles, and I wanted to find out how our universe works. And none of the answers that I found in old cosmology articles made any sense. So I started looking and putting together those things that work and make sense. And the first thing that comes to my mind, the key to unlocking everything, was when you strike a match, light is moving out at 186,000 miles per second, and regardless of what quantum mechanics says, that there are a mathematical difference in some kind of a wave function doesn't drive electrons or photons at that speed. So this was the starting point. And I continue going on to figure out how I can relate that to the Big Bang.
What do you mean by singularity?
Singularity was the description by Lamette in 1931, where he reworked Einstein's equations, and he says, seems to me from these mathematics that if the universe, if, he says, and he published in Nature with that beginning word, if the universe started out of a quantum like a singleton, a quantum effect, that maybe the universe, started a little bit before them. These are ifs and maybes, and these are mathematical concepts, not physical concepts.
Do you have more material you want to share with us?
Pardon me?
Do you have more material?
Oh yeah, I got lots. I have.
Shall we let our
next question?
He's got a lot of stuff here. We got to move.
Let's go.
Let's go. Uh-huh.
Okay. So where did the Big Bang take place?
Cleveland.
You're right, Cleveland, Ohio. Mr. B, where does the universe start and where does it end? Elmo, that question has stumped the world's best thinkers. I know. That's why I thought I start asking around at the other end. I'm not a good storyteller, but I have found a few cartoons about the universe that I thought were amusing, and I have saved them over the years, and I try to put some of them in here to make this a more relaxed atmosphere. So the next thing were, fortunately for my study, we got the Hubble Space Telescope. And it found some great things. After they corrected its vision problems, its focusing, the director, Robert Williams, pointed the telescope north. And what he did was he selected a spot that from Earth-based telescopes had nothing in it. And a lot of people would say, well, what are you wasting your time looking down there for? But the Hubble Space Telescope looked down that long narrow tube and found what ultimately became 10,000 galaxies that they called the North Deep Field. At first it was just a deep field, but it was pointed north. And 3 years later, they pointed it south and they found basically the same thing called the South Deep Field. And they did that in 98, roughly 13 billion light years from Earth. These galaxies.
Whoa.
Recently also, we've set up a satellite called WMAP, the Wilkinson satellite, and it recorded radiation from deep space that we could see on an old TV set that was static, and that's that cosmic microwave background radiation, and we see it coming equally from every direction at 13.8 billion light years. That's the cosmic microwave background radiation. It surrounds Earth in all directions, some 13.8 billion light years distance. It's like a spherical fog bank that cannot be penetrated by the Hubble Space Telescope. So Earth is like in the center of a center slice of our universe. There's much more evidence in this presentation talking about Earth's central location in our universe. This was first reported in 2003 by the BBC, and this picture was assembled by Dr. Max Tegmark of the University of Pennsylvania using this Wilkinson satellite information. And one of the questions presented to the astrological questions saying this is absolutely like a celestial sphere with Earth in the center. So what is a celestial sphere? It's a schematic using for coordinating how to plot celestial objects. And what we do is we have lines of demarcation, red ascension, which are like time zones. The celestial sphere is divided up into 24 zones and for right ascension and for declination we have the equator and lines parallel to the equator running at from 90 positive degrees to negative 90 degrees. So we could use this for plotting what we see in the night sky. And from our central location in the universe, we see the whole night sky from a orbiting Hubble Space Telescope, putting Earth in the center of our celestial sphere. And we add to this the North Deep Field, some 13 billion light years for us. The coordinates are provided for us by NASA. The South Deep Field, again, we could plot that on our celestial sphere, and that the coordinates are also provided for us by NASA. You could find them on the web. Okay, so now, this is a three-dimensional object. So if I have a north view and a south view, it's not, I can't say with any specificity where Earth is. However, I forgot to tell you, we got the cosmic microwave background surrounding us. We found in 2003 a cold spot in the cosmic microwave background. And the cold spot is just a statistically colder than the almost uniform temperature of the cosmic microwave background. And it's statistically significant, and I'm plotting it for you on this sphere. That's about where NASA finds it. And we'll put this on our already plotted sphere. And I now have three fixed items to measure where Earth's location is. We have the North Deep Field on the top, the South Deep Field on the bottom, and the cold spot off to a side. And if I was looking down the from an intersection a mile down south, and I saw the red lights, and I looked a mile down north, and I saw another stoplight, and I looked down the diagonal street, and I could see a restaurant light, I should only be in one place to see all three lights with those angles. That's known as triangulation. And it's just like trying to find a ship at sea who sent out a distress signal and is picked up by several antennas. We can, if we know where the antennas are located, and we know their angles and their distances, we can figure out where that ship at sea is at. We can pinpoint its location, triangulation. So we do the same thing with Earth and this North Field, the South Deep Field, and the cold spot by triangulation, putting Earth virtually in the center of our observable universe. So the where? The Big Bang banged and shot matter in all directions, filling up our universe. The first out of the Big Bang moved out the fastest, forming the cosmic microwave background radiation and the deep field galaxies. And last out of the Big Bang moved out the slowest, forming Earth as part of the local group of galaxies. So the Big Bang explosion exploded in pre-existing space, supplying all the evidence disclaiming the need for expanding or accelerating space, which the mathematicians like to say that the distance between galaxies is not due to an explosion in space, but that space is expanding, although there is no physical evidence in any lab showing that we have an expansion of space. And I seem to notice that while we're here this evening, space hasn't expanded between any of us. That's the end of chapter two, putting Earth in the center of the universe.
Shall we continue?
Go on sure. To chapter three.
Yeah.
Okay, the demonstration of chapter three. Explosions. Supernovas can briefly outshine entire galaxies. And the gamma ray burst, otherwise known as the GRB, shines hundreds of times brighter than a typical supernova. And they do that in 1 to 2 minutes, and then they're gone. Now, the expanding space concept was derived by Willem de Sitter in 1915 to 1919. He came up with a solution of Einstein's equations, which includes a universe without matter that's expanding. That's a mathematical concept. Looking at supernovas, before the Hubble Space Telescope was developed, we could find supernovas in this A group. And the further the supernova was seen, the dimmer it was. And we saw a one-to-one relationship for the A group going all the way out. But then lo and behold, the Hubble Space Telescope found more supernovas further out, but they didn't follow that one-to-one relationship. The line curved up slightly. And so if you averaged that scatter plot, you found that, hey, they just don't fit the normal pattern. Well, it's one thing to talk about averages, but the scatter plot was reality. The diagonal average line is only a statistic. You know, mathematicians can do all kinds of things with statistics. So we're going to compare that supernova chart to the gamma ray burst. And here's one of several thousand gamma ray charts recorded by NASA. And this thing, this is a 60-second long explosion. It starts out very powerfully at the top. And we see it's a very pulsating explosion. It diminishes rapidly and levels out until finally it peters out. So this gamma ray burst is, I want to use this as a model for the Big Bang. It's like a skyrocket burst or a continuous volcanic explosion. This pulsating gamma ray burst is like a shrinking string of firecrackers. The first firecracker is the biggest, and the last firecracker in this group is the smallest, weakest. As we further go down the line, we end up with less and less power available. So the very first was the most powerful, the last is the weakest, pushing Earth out the slowest. Using this gamma ray burst as a model for the Big Bang explosion, we convert dark energy into matter. It starts out very powerfully. It rapidly declines in power. It ends with a much weaker push, driving Earth out. And so the best explanation for describing the increasing distance between celestial objects is a gamma ray burst explosion in space, pulsating. There is no math space expansion. Documenting Earth's very slow speed, which is the last out of the explosion, we find many studies performed by various groups, including this COBE satellite, which unfortunately doesn't show up real powerfully in this picture, but you can see this at the astronomical picture of the day. They repeated this about 10 times because they like this so much. It says that Earth and our local family of galaxies is moving through the cosmic microwave background at some 600 kilometers per second. This is super fast. 600 kilometers per second is equal to 375 miles per second. And when you think about a rifle bullet moving at about a mile or two per second, 375 miles per second is super fast. But when we compare that speed to the speed of light, that's 600 kilometers divided by 300,000 kilometers per second, the speed of light, we are super slow, 0.2%. We are the snail of the universe. We were the last out of the explosion, just about. So here's that gamma ray burst graph. And we compare it with the supernova graph. And we can see that from a little below the peak, that little circle area, that a very pulsating explosion, driving out that matter, which formed those galaxies that had supernovas in that B group on the right, which was a little bit off that one-to-one scale. And you could see that the power is changing continually from the peak till it comes down to the plateau, making for a scattered distribution of supernovas. You don't need expanding space. So the first atomic matter from the Big Bang formed the cosmic microwave background, moving out at almost the speed of light. That's my next chapter. The next particles form those galaxies that include supernovas that we showed about that group B. And then in this whole 60-second explosion, we've created all the matter that formed all the atoms in our universe. And last was a very slow-moving Earth coming out near the end of this pulsating explosion. And that's the recapitulation of that. So no expanding space is required, just dark energy, which converts in pre-existing space, like that Stanford experiment, shooting out hot embers of atomic matter that in time formed all the celestial objects that we see in the night sky, and very slow Earth seizes it all from the center. That's just, again, I'll repeat that, very slow Earth, end of chapter 3.
Go on to chapter 4.
Yeah, go on to chapter 4.
Chapter 4, when? When did this take place? So I showed you the cosmic microwave background radiation of the sphere recorded by Max Tegmark with us in the center of it. The astronomical picture of the day in 2003 showed the spheres. And so here's where Earth is at. I took one of the spheres and I sliced it open, put Earth in the center of the center slice. Earth's view is the same in all directions. And there's a few other graphics that show the same thing. For example, this one, where Earth is 13.8 billion light years away from the cosmic microwave background smoke fog. Here's another view of the same thing. Is the cosmic microwave background is like a sphere, and if we cut out, exposing the center where the Big Bang took place, the epicenter, Earth is right next to it. So now, here's a schematic of the Big Bang explosion. The Big Bang exploded and shot out those hot atomic embers that we saw from the Galileo first, chapter 3. And so, if you wanted to see where the Big Bang, that singular start, it had to be outside, away from the light photons. We couldn't be in the white area, we'd have to be in the gray area to see where that start of the Big Bang. And what we do see is the radiation coming from the cooling CMB embers returning, not from the Big Bang, but from the embers. We have to be out in the gray area if we wanted to see the actual start of the Big Bang. So, if we think about looking at a campfire and we see flying embers shooting out, like when this first ember is flying out, when we see it, that little arrow pointing back at the fire, that ember has moved away. We see the photon from where we thought the ember was, but it's no longer there. So every time that ember shoots out, it's shooting out radiation in all directions, we only see where it was, not where it's at. So the Big Bang takes place. It shoots out the most powerful matter first, moving at near the speed of light, and it reaches 13.8 billion light years from us. And all the time it's running away from the Big Bang, it's radiating energy in all directions. And so finally it gets to this 13.8 billion light year distance from us, and that radiation comes back and we see it. So it took 13 to 14 billion years to go out to where we see it. And it took the speed of light, that radiation came back to us at 13.8 billion years. So it's a round trip from the explosion to where we see the CMB embers from, and it's light and it's radiation returning back to us. It's a somewhat complicated concept, but that tells us how the universe started 28 billion years ago. And we have telescopic support for where Earth is at. We have pie-shaped charts from the telescope and the pie-shaped charts are due to Earth's view of our universe limited to this, that seen above and below our location in the Milky Way galaxy. Here's the luminous red galaxies and normal galaxies created by Sloan Digital Sky Survey. You can find this on the web at that link. And you see that the distribution of red galaxies are above and below, like looking at a donut. If we could see through the Milky Way galaxy, that pattern would be all around, would be like in the center of an onion. This is another survey doing quasars, and this goes out to about 14 billion light years from Earth. It's taken in Australia. It's called the 2DF graph. And Earth, if we look in every direction for a billion years, we don't see any quasars. And then if you look in both directions, you can see a similar pattern in both directions, putting Earth again in the center of our universe. And here's a combined chart by another group showing the regular galaxies and the quasars and Earth again in the center. And here's again, I'm just reminding you, very slow Earth. And here's that description of those embers again. The Big Bang takes place. The embers shoot up to the where the cold spot, where the cosmic microwave background radiation is emitted from where we see it, and that we see it after it has traveled that back to us 13.8 billion years, or a round trip of 28 billion years. So the calculation of when. We start out in chapter 1, we show the explosion in pre-existing space. In chapter 2, we show that the center of our observable universe using the Hubble Space Telescope, the North Deep Field and the South Deep Field. In chapter 3, we show the gamma ray burst, the pulsating graph, models the Big Bang explosion. And in chapter 4, we recognize that the cosmic microwave background radiation embers traveled out, and the radiation returned back to us, 28 billion years, the age of all the atoms making up our universe. And that's the end of chapter 4. And chapter 5, the formation of galaxies. We need to consider the age of the galaxies. The youngest galaxy we could see is 14 billion years, and everything we see, we take a photograph, for example, of everybody here. Everybody's different age. And it's the same thing with all the galaxies in the night sky. The closest ones to us are the oldest, and the one furthest away from us are the youngest. Second consideration, we have the pulsating explosive push, showing that we have scatter plot distribution of all our galaxies. When the Big Bang took place, there was a lot of turbulence, and at the same time the Big Bang took place, we have something that we've become aware of called the turbonuclear electromagnetic pulse that accompanies a nuclear explosion that is very destructive and very wide effects. And also we have gravity helping us to form all these galaxies. So the dark energy in space converged to a small enough space, and it shot, converted that energy into matter, and we have galaxies with complete 100 degrees of freedom of motion, so that our galaxies are in a complete variety of orientations, sizes, shapes. That's not possible with a space expansion. If people sat outside and looked at the stars each night, I bet they'd live a lot differently, says Kelvin. How so? Well, when you look into infinity, you realize that there are more important things than what people do all day. We spent our day looking under rocks in the creek, Kelvin says, well, I mean other people.
Okay, Robert?
So the evidence I presented today, strike a match, Hadron's anneals, the atomic bomb, dark energy, Stanford lab conversion, the cosmic microwave background radiation, NASA deep fields, the cold spot of the CMB, triangulation, very slow Earth, the jagged cheek gamma ray burst explosion, scattered supernovas, and NASA observations.
Frankly, I'm so snowed I don't know what to ask. But, yes, Dean Penner.
Yeah. Okay, there's two concepts of time here. We talk, let's say, 14 billion years. That's Earth time. Then we talk about this other thing, this unbelievable number, 14 billion light years. How could that exist? How could they have 14 billion years of actual time for Earth, of a universe developing, and we got these 14 billion light years?
What happens?
Doesn't make any sense.
The thing, the measurement of our universe is how far can light travel in 14 billion years? And since light travels at the speed of light, that 14 billion years is also the same as 14 billion light years if you're moving at the speed of light. And the light photons coming back from the cosmic microwave background radiation move at the speed of light.
Sir, light years are a measurement of distance.
That's correct.
See, light years are not a measurement of time. They're a measurement of distance.
Thank you.
I find that light has to travel.
Yeah, but it's not a measurement of distance.
Right. Okay.
I mean,
all right,
years
well,
are a measurement
we'll start
of time.
With Boucher.
Yes, I'd like to know, well, one of the things that surprised me was you were making the, according to your calculations, the Earth is the center of all this creation. You don't explain anything about the planets, and a secondary question is, do any of the experts support your theories about all this stuff?
Probably not.
Well, you haven't explained the other planets in our system. There are, you know, there's
I haven't even explained what I have tried to present in enough depth. But the time is limited, and your attention span and my ability to present it is.
David Travis.
Yeah, that 14 billion years you're talking about.
Yes.
Is that the before Common Era or after Common Era?
Yes. I like the questions of before and after, yes.
All right. David Sucker.
Do scientists still visualize the atom as a miniature solar system?
I don't know.
All right, Dan.
Yes.
Weinberg.
At one point, you said that the Earth was 13 point whatever billion light years
from the cosmic microwave background radiation.
Okay.
That's measured by the NASA satellite WMAP.
Okay, but how can the idea that the Earth is in the middle, could that be idea?
Well, actually, Earth is probably about 0.2% away from the epicenter of the Big Bang, probably something like 50 million light years from the center, which is pretty close to dead center.
Could that be a false idea, something like the sun going around the moon? Could that be just a...
I don't think the sun goes around the moon anymore.
I mean the Earth. The Earth.
The Earth being...
Charles?
Yeah, so all this dark energy, and there's also dark matter, but you seem to think conveniently that doesn't exist.
I didn't say the dark matter didn't exist, I just didn't discuss it.
But for some reason, all this dark energy is out there, and then one day in the cosmological history of the universe, they kind of like decided, saying, hey, let's all become matter.
Yes.
And
one of the things I'd like to say is that science can find the tools, philosophy seeks the craftsman. We could find all these things, but we don't know why they work the way they work. And the craftsman is, I leave up to philosophers to describe.
Has anybody been able to convert dark energy into matter?
Yeah, they did it in an experiment.
In the Big Bang. And in the sun. The sun is converting dark energy into heat that we use to support life on Earth.
I thought that was called fusion.
Helium.
Well, you could call it fusion.
That's not dark energy.
Yeah. But while you do that, you are taking the atoms and you're putting them together, and the excess energy is reflected out very powerfully that fuels the sun. And the sun is continually being constricted in that fusion process.
Okay. That's chemistry.
I was a little confused. I thought you were saying that the Big Bang was the traditional Big Bang that we're used to thinking about, and that it was caused by dark energy, a dark energy field that existed before that or outside of it. And then you said that the Big Bang was a gamma ray burst.
I'm using the gamma ray burst explosion graph as a model for the Big Bang. And I'm saying that the gamma ray burst explosion took place in about a minute or two, and we could see that the explosion started out very powerfully and rapidly diminished and plateaued out. And what my thesis is that the dark energy existing in pre-existing space, probably running almost infinitely in every direction, probably ran every kind of pattern possible over almost an infinite amount of time, till eventually a sufficient amount of the dark energy converged to a small enough spot that set off the conversion of energy into matter, just like they did in Stanford. Yes, Amen. Yes.
The super collider in, I think it's in Switzerland, they're trying to produce a black hole. Do you think that's dangerous?
You give a little kid a sledgehammer and a grandfather's clock, and you say, let's take it apart and smash it and see what you get from it. That's what they're doing in Switzerland.
We had a program on that.
Yes.
Do you think the universe is infinite or finite? If it's finite, what lies outside the universe?
I started out by saying about dark energy probably filled up all of space for all of time prior to the Big Bang, and this dark energy eventually ran every kind of pattern until a sufficient amount, not all the dark energy, a sufficient amount converged into a smaller space that set off the conversion of energy into matter like they did at Stanford. But we still had a tremendous amount of dark energy that is continually powering all the atoms that make up our universe, all the atoms in your body, my body, in Earth, in the sun, is being powered by this dark energy. And its energy field is beyond our ability to measure, and our technology is beyond our technology to be able to be aware of that. We cannot see through the cosmic microwave background radiation. It's like a fog bank surrounding us 14 billion light years in every direction. So now, we can't see beyond it. How can I tell you what is beyond it if I can't see beyond it? I could surmise just like anybody else can. Yes, Charles.
Yeah, Charles, you're saying that Big Bang's like a gamma ray bursts, but I think those are like supernovas, and there's at least one gamma ray burst a year.
One a day.
In our galaxy.
Not in our galaxy. There are no gamma ray bursts in our galaxy. There might be a supernova explosion in our galaxy, about one, generally about an explosion of a supernova, one per galaxy per century. Gamma ray bursts, we sense with our satellite about one a day.
Yeah, so what makes this the one that created the universe? These are regular ongoing events in
the explosion,
the sky.
The explosion that created the Big Bang is probably 50 million times larger than our gamma ray bursts to create all the matter that exists in our universe. Now, I can put together a lot of the picture, but I can't go back to that time and measure how powerfully that gamma ray, how powerful the Big Bang was, any more than anyone else can. But I can put a scenario showing you how it's more plausible than a mathematical equation that says our universe started from nothing. Way in the back.
Yeah, time started with the Big Bang, right?
No. We don't know when time started.
According to some scientists.
Yes, that's a mathematical concept.
Any relationship between dark energy and dark matter?
Mathematical. Yes.
Some scientists have dabbled with the idea that there are several universes.
Oh, yes. Wonderful fiction. You know, I could talk about how many angels are on a pinhead. You want to believe me? Okay. If I could talk, say that there's 15,000 universes. Am I any more believable? If I said, here's a formula showing you that there's 1,527,000 universes. Here's the formula. Doesn't it look beautiful? It's all typed out. It's neat. It's got all kinds of symbols. Is that any more believable than the number of angels on a pinhead? You follow? I mean, it's wonderful. You can come up with all kinds of what ifs.
What kind of matter did Stanford create? What was the matter?
It was not even a form. They didn't even form an atom. It was a electron. I'm sorry, I don't remember exactly the right term, but they were just bits like you would find when they smash an atom. You get a little parts of an atom shooting off in both directions. They had the positive and the negative aspects of them, and they disappeared almost instantaneously. But theoretically, they were scientists have believed that there was always Einstein's equation of E equals mc squared, energy equals matter, can go in both directions, and Stanford showed that it works.
Just tell him no problem.
You said there was the same amount of atoms in existence today that there were at the time of the Big Bang.
For the most part, there might have been some destroyed, like an atomic bomb.
But my question is,
yes,
when we bombed Hiroshima and Nagasaki,
yeah,
and in which atoms were split up,
yeah, probably
doesn't that lessen the number of atoms?
Yeah, about the number of atoms equal to the number of atoms in 1/4 of a dime.
Yeah, I understand. Nevertheless,
super tiny. Yes.
Does lessen the number of atoms.
Right.
But
all right, Angelos.
How will our solar system end? I heard that the sun's going to expand and burn up the.
That's not part of my presentation or my study. I mean, I can tell you that what scientists say, that the sun is going to probably do that in about 5 billion years.
5 billion years, right.
But don't hold your breath.
Rebunk. All right.
tonight.
Okay.
Yes, I think we will have to move on to rebuttal. We seem to have run out of questions
all right.
at the moment.
Let's move on to rebuttals.
Can I have a...
Bring up your question
what do you need?
But,
what do you need? Glass of water?
No, I was wondering if I could get a little some supper.
Yeah, well, once we start the rebuttal period, we'll sit down, we'll get you all hooked up with Susie. She'll be able to take care of you with no problem.
Okay, fine.
We'll give you right here and no problem whatsoever.
Okay.
All right, when you're ready to start the rebuttals, let's...
All right, how many people have comments to make?
One right behind.
1, 2, 3, 4...
I don't know the protocol.
No, that's okay. No, you're going to sit down.
Go eat.
Go eat.
I shall.
I have one more question.
Well, let's get to ask it.
All right. If the Earth is right near the center of the Big Bang where it took place, why did it take 14 million years for the Earth to form? You think we would have been... Like day two?
All right.
We're right at the center. You have the chart, right?
Yes, we're 50 million light years from the epicenter, okay?
And
the Big Bang took place and shot out, and it's we're 28 billion light years, we're 28 billion years after the explosion, and the matter that shot out, the Earth being about the last out of the explosion, gravity, thermonuclear electrical pulse, friction, turbulence put together all these atoms and formed our Milky Way galaxy and the local family galaxies.
The singularity it's creating matter.
No singularity.
And we are near, right near the beginning, so we should have been one of the first things made.
I got mine on.
You can leave him your question.
Charlie, leave that up.
Oh.
We're gonna leave it up for put it off a little.
I was trying to turn this off, but
go ahead and turn it off.
What?
Turn yours off.
Yeah.
I don't wish to cast aspersions on our speaker, but I think we should applaud and thank him for this.
Oh, thank you.
About what? How long? About 5 minutes, 6 minutes apiece?
Don't restrict. As I said, I don't want to cast aspersions on our speaker, but notice the fact we do have a problem. I don't question his love of amateur cosmology either. I think he's very sincere about that. But I think both he and everyone here who is interested in cosmology should attend the Compton lectures at the University of Chicago and find out what's really happening. And second, I want to apologize to any and all of you who may have come tonight at my invitation. Cosmology, as presented by our speaker, did not occur in the way he thought it did. I'm an astrophysicist, and I've dealt with this. But the origin of the universe was not atoms. It was the constituents of atoms, the quarks, the leptons and so forth. Did it originate at a point? We have no idea. Are we at the center of the universe? No, of course not. We are in the present, so if the universe is expanding or contracting, we are at the forefront of that. So there's no question that we are moving somewhere. Cosmology is a strange subject. It is a conceptual study rather than a mathematical study or a physics study. It does represent the sum of knowledge of what we're doing in the field of astrophysics, but it's not simple, and it continually changes. And implied in our speaker's presentation is the fact that the laws of nature have remained constant over the period of what is thought to be 13.78 billion years of existence. But the interesting thing is, as far as our telescopes can see, before things dim out because they're so far away, is doesn't mean that's the end of the universe. The universe could go on for hundreds of millions of light years and we would never know it, because we can't see that far. So I want to thank our speaker for his courage in undertaking this event.
Next.
Yeah, my name is Doug Binkley. I would also like to commend the speaker for trying to come up with a theory. There's certainly a lot of unexplained things in cosmology. I have a degree in physics from IIT, just a bachelor's degree, but I did involve myself in some graduate level study at that time. I was going through some of my things just very briefly. I found a book here published in 1972 by Steven Weinberg, a Nobel-winning physicist called Gravitation and Cosmology. And yeah, it's full of equations. Most of these I can't understand unless I were to take a lot of time to delve into them, and a lot of prerequisites, reviewing stuff that some I did know back then and some I would have to know again. But this, there's no substitute for this difficulty of going into very, very detailed work. And the reason why that's done by scientists is unless you do calculations and unless they represent reality, a theory is just that. It's a theory. And what we have done in our history of science is we have strived to come up with things that are as close to the truth as they can be, and we strive to disprove theories which can be done, they can be disproved, because they don't represent what is observed in the real world. Now, when he was discussing and making out that he had an explanation for the Big Bang, he actually might have hit on something, because when the dark energy was not known in this 1974 time frame, so advances have been made since then, although a lot of current cosmology is included in the studies that going way back a long way. Of course, the big discovery was the expansion of the universe, and it's kind of funny that he rejected that at the end of his talk and couldn't really get into that. First of all, he put up a graph where he appeared to believe in the graph that explained the described the expanding universe. And then he said it wasn't so. I didn't get that. But and then maybe it's in this book. But at any rate, the expansion of the universe is thought to have been a result of something called inflation, extra expansion. The initial expansion of the Big Bang, of course, was great enough. It was a very big thing. But the inflation is thought that it might be a result of this dark energy field that he was describing. Now, the dark energy field, however, as far as can be told by observation, is that it is a constant energy density throughout space. It's only increasing because space is expanding, and that is causing an increase of the dark energy. But there's no difference in energy from one point of space, space-time, to another.
Question from the audience. What's the gross national product of the dark energy field?
Well, let's not discuss things outside the subject of the talk.
It should be uninterrupted.
The dark energy field, having no difference in energy from one place to another, can't really be used to push electrons out of atoms, and it can't really be used to fuel the stars. The stars, it's well known the stars are fueled by nuclear fusion, and there's many big books that explain that, and again, you've got to really study hard for years. That's why we have PhDs, unfortunately, in order to understand the intricacies of the fusion process. It's a very complicated process, actually. There's a number of atoms involved, and deuterium and all of that stuff. What I'm getting at is that the theory is not full, but he hit upon something which was interesting, which he was trying to use the dark energy in a qualitative way to describe how it might have resulted in the initial Big Bang that created our universe, and that there could be something before or beside, that there could be a parameter that we might call a megatime instead of the time that is supposed to begin at the Big Bang. And again, it's only supposed to begin at the Big Bang because there's a singularity there.
there could be more complicated physics, which involve equations even more serious than the ones in her book, that would hopefully describe what happens when there's not, if there wasn't a singularity, if it did come from another, from a proto-universe, something before or on the side, in another space-time or something similar. There's theories that there's universes stacked on one another and somehow meet. There's theories of bubble universes, and our Big Bang is part of a bubble that came from a previous universe or a universe existing in some other set of mathematical parameters. So this, if this dark energy was something that was before our universe or outside of our universe, and it did fluctuate in some way, maybe there's quantum mechanical fluctuations in it, that might be, he might have hit upon something that's worth investigating. Okay, so thank you very much.
I think that's
all right, Mr. Travis.
David Travis.
We'll go 6 minutes each.
Thank you. I don't believe in black holes in outer space. I think that there is space, and then there are solid things like planets.
And or, free markets.
Thank you. Or gaseous things like a sun or something like that. I think that it's interesting to note that time and space are very, very interrelated. That's why I don't believe that we could, for example, build a time machine and go back to the St. Valentine's Day Massacre or the American Revolution, because that if we did build a machine to be able to do that, it would only be a visual thing, like seeing a movie. You could not interact with it. However, I believe in order to interact, to go back in time and interact in those events, that the Earth and the planets would have to be put back in the exact same position that they were in when those events took place in the first place. But inasmuch as every planet gives off a ray of light, and that ray of light can be picked up even a billion years later, that another civilization could look at that light and determine things that were happening on Earth so many eons of light years ago, if they could sort out, if they could have a machine that would sort out those events. But I further believe that you cannot make nothing out of something. You can convert energy into material things, and you convert material things into energy, but you can't make nothing into something, and you can't make something from nothing. This is a given. However, there's an exception to that. I believe that, it's a fact that now we know that you can make nothing from something. Our political leaders have proven that.
Thank you.
I think the Earth is like a microcosm of the universe to a large degree. Some of the laws on our planet are very similar to the laws in outer space. Like you said, singularity. Now, what is singularity? Singularity means there's one thing and something comes out of it. But throughout, is, on this planet, whenever there's a change, there's always a contradiction. In other words, there's two parts to everything, like male and female, heat and cold, and so forth and so on. These are contradictions. So when you have a contradiction, something could come out of it, but not out of something single or singularity. That doesn't make sense. Another thing is chaos and order. Now we have both on our planet. For instance, let's say we have chaos. We have an earthquake. What happens during an earthquake? Of course, the earth moves, buildings come down, so forth and so on. But as a consequence of earthquakes, we've learned how to build buildings that withstand it to some degree. And the further we get along in science, we learn more and more about earthquakes and how to make buildings earthquake-proof to a higher degree. So we get order out of chaos. This is one of the basic laws of matter. So when he's talking about, he doesn't know if there's chaos or order in the world, we could see how chaos and order work together. How from chaos we get a higher order once we solve the problem. And then we get more chaos, and we solve that problem, we get a higher order. So this is part of the laws of matter, just some of the basic laws of matter. And, well, that's about it, I guess.
All right.
You got me reset?
I'm going to reset. It's starting now.
Okay, thank you. Well, I'd like to thank our speaker. It was a very interesting presentation. I always admire people that have more or less colorful charts. And so I like the way that the presentation, well, the information was brought in piecemeal. It was very interesting to see. But I don't know if I agree with all the content of the presentation. I personally believe in string theory, and the beginning in string theory with the beginning of the universe, they talk about the collision of brains that unleashed all the matter of the universe. Brains are like balloons that collided in space. It's sort of a different approach to the singular Big Bang theory. That was in a presentation I did in a college a few months back. Personally, I prefer the Bible story in creation. In the beginning was God, and he created light, and then there was the earth and animals and things like that afterward. It's a lot easier to understand. Where he said that the earth was kind of like in the center of the universe. I've seen charts over at the planetarium where they have a picture of the universe. I don't know if any of you have been to the planetarium, the Adler planetarium. And they have a little picture of the universe, and in the lower right-hand corner, it says, "You are here." You know, that's a far point away from being in the middle of the universe. And one of the things that I subscribe to, we were talking about black holes from the previous rebutter, and I believe that's where heaven is. You know, they say a black hole is where light cannot escape. So I believe that we're all destined to wind up in a black hole after we pass from this earth. And that's about it. Oh yeah, I wanted to say too, I was whispering this to Dave, there is a relationship between dark matter and dark energy. They're both dark, you know, like dark chocolate and semi-sweet dark chocolate. Thank you.
Next speaker.
Next.
Oh. All right.
Well, I'll go. Go ahead, Brian.
I'm completely lost as far as the measurements of the age of the universe or the size of the universe, or whether there is a size to the universe, or what lies beyond the universe.
Yeah,
it's not something I deal with day to day, and or that I can do much about. But we have traditions about beginnings. They're in the Hebrew Bible, which begins with Genesis, which means beginnings. In the beginning, God created. There was God. And what does it mean to be a God? It means that you're worshipped. It means that it's something that you revere, that determines how you think, how you feel, something important that's essential. And when it's the Hebrew God, the God of Israel, it's the God who gives orders, makes promises, and loves people. That's the source of the meaning of the universe. That's what Genesis is telling us. The source of the meaning of our world, our cosmos, your world, my world, some Martian's world, or some planet, or you know, whatever, it's the life impulse that gives meaning to things, because things take meaning, from life. And there are different days of creation. There are different kinds of creation. There are, and they build on one another. And in the seventh day, life rested from all life's work. And what does life do? Life blesses everything that is made. It's all good that there is meaning. And whether it's good or bad, it's good that there is meaning. All right? And then in the Christian dispensation, there's the Gospel of John that begins out of this Hebrew tradition. In the beginning was the Word, the meaning. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The Word was with God in the beginning. Everything came into being through the Word. Nothing came into being without it. What came into being through the Word was life, and the life was the light of all people. So that's a little bit about what beginnings are in the Hebrew Christian.
And now we know.
Yes. Amen. And the prophets.
The collection basket will be passed around after that sermon. But I did want to say that last Monday, on the Late Show that was hosted by Stephen Colbert, he said, "I am honored to interview the last president of the United States, Donald Trump."
Yeah. Yeah. Hey, he's my guy.
I built for the socialists, that's for sure. I got a button here that says Hillary for prison. Whoa. All right, let's thank our speaker for all it. Really, I put these PowerPoints together. This is a lot of work. And he went with me high tech on this. And by the way, we need some batteries for this puppy. I'll be eclectic as usual. Dave, I think there's, I could be stand corrected on this, but I think there's 84 identifiable objects in the solar system or somewhere along the line. That's always amazed me. I wonder the variety of things that are floating around out there, you know. Endless amount of study. I can appreciate autodidactic efforts. He spent 18 years at this. We had a regular at the college for many, many years. One of the keystone members of the college complex is the late Lee Hubble, who loved this topic. He had no academic credentials, yet he pursued the topic endlessly for decades and gave us lectures on time to time, perhaps through the pedestrian approach to some, but I'll be honest with you, I kind of get in and out of the topic enough to feel comfortable, you know, or maybe a supernova special or something like that. It encompasses so much from subatomic physics through astronomy that I don't know where you begin. I've had some enjoyable evenings here. Doug mentioned it. He gave us an entire evening somehow trying to ascertain that the string theory was in fact in the Bible, which I found intriguing. And then Jill Meyer, I'm not going to let you off the hook, spoke to the cosmology complexes predicting some sort of cosmic death, which was going to happen. I think he gave that 5 years ago, so I guess we've had a period of
We're getting closer.
So look out tomorrow. He went on that we were all going to die, you know. And any day now, he with some degree of assurance, you know. So I'm not certain who I should listen to in this regard. You know, actually, there's one thing that's amazed me about this topic, singularly amazed me, is these guys come along and they say, well, the Earth was created 13.7 billion years ago. And the first time I encountered that bit of information, I said, that's singularly amazing that anybody could arrive at that fact with confidence. And then not only did they say, but he had it in his chart. Not only did they go back 13.7 billion years, which is not like yesterday, but they tell you what happened in the first second. Now this is amazing that you could tell me what took place. And I've seen these charts, and apparently there's total verification of this. There's no dispute. But I must credit the scientific community on this, you know. But anyhow, it's a fun topic. If you just want to have some fun, I believe, if you just want to have some fun, the Science Channel, I believe, used to dedicate Tuesday evening to documentaries of astrophysics and stuff like that the entire evening, which is a very comfortable and easy way and probably more than enough that most people need to approach the topic without getting into the thing. But then again, one last word of advice for the Chicago Astronomy Society. I have to agree with my Brahm here and Doug here. You know, you guys, instead of looking into your telescopes, why don't you look into your Bible?
Okay.
I want to know how the universe works. Yeah. Get a Bible.
I love this topic because it gives us a little bit of an insight into the power that is in the atom. and what we can do with it if we harness it properly.
Thorium.
Of course. What else do you think I was going to bring up? Specifically the decayed chain of thorium from when bombarded by a free neutron due to uranium-233. Decays over a 30-day period and can rejuvenate itself. Anyway, I won't get much more into that. I just basically want to thank our speaker tonight for bringing up a very good topic, being very well prepared, and I'd like to give another round of applause.
Thank you very much.
And that's all I really got to say.
Wow. You did it in less than a minute.
Come on, we got other speakers here.
Anybody else?
You mean we are at a loss for words from the College of Complexes?
In that case, well, we'll be interrupting his meal.
No, well, we'll,
all right.
Joe, why don't you enlighten us a little more if you can?
Strike a match.
Will miracles ever cease? We're at a loss for words at the College of Complexes.
We're just overwhelmed.
Come on, Joe. You can give us you have a little time, so explain yourself and.
Well, I would like to clarify one thing. One of our rebutters asked about singularities. What is a singularity? It's a place where our mathematics disappears. It had nothing to do with the physical reality of the universe. It's just that our mathematics are so primitive that they don't work at these conditions and times. The universe was started somehow, whether it be with the collision of brains, membranes, as they're known, which implies the existence of many, many other universes. Recent work by Lee Smolin and Robert Unger have shown that you can only have one universe at a time. First of all, time is real. It's not space-time. Time is separate and real. The ability of us to combine these things shows our basic ignorance. Einstein was ignorant also of these things, but he did make some important discoveries. For example, he said gravity is not something that sucks you down. It's a warping of space-time. In other words, we feel the force of gravity on the Earth not because the Earth is pulling us down, but space is pushing us down. The for lack of a term, the density of space is in the presence of matter is actually pushing us down toward the Earth. And so it is, no matter how far away you get. It diminishes, of course, the further away you get. But nonetheless, space is pushing us down. Space is pushing the planets around the sun. They have an initial velocity, but then space is pushing them toward the sun, so they go in elliptical orbits. Atoms were not the first items that were created in the so-called Big Bang. It is a fact that there are leptons, which are electrons and muons, that were created in a very early period, maybe 1/10 millionth of a second after the Big Bang, Charlie. But quarks were formed, and now it appears from the experiments at CERN, at the Large Hadron Collider in Switzerland, that there may be constituents of quarks. And they have found quarks occur in two, that we thought they occurred, in 3 and 2 units. It takes 3 quarks to make a neutron and a proton. It takes 2 quarks to make a muon, which is a lepton. It's confusing, but they had just recently discovered enough evidence with a significant, what they call, probability of
four sigma, which means very, very likely. They have discovered a pentaquark, an object that has five quarks in it. And so that means that the quark is really an independent object by itself. But the quark obeys a law that is much different than the ones that we're used to. Gravity, for example, the further away you get from an object, the less you feel gravity. But in the case of quark, it's the strong force. The further apart you pull two quarks, if you could do it, the stronger the force gets. And the energy used to pull them apart eventually creates another pair of quarks in between the two quarks. So it's that comes out of quantum mechanics, Doug. And it's really complicated, but you do have to spend a lifetime thinking about these things. Brother Travis?
Yeah, is that the same as four quarks making a gallon?
Exactly. But what do five quarks make?
A gallon and a quark.
Is it still true that the flavors of quarks are upness, downness, strangeness, charm, truth, and beauty?
Yes, as a matter of fact, they are. That's names they give them because they didn't know what else to call them.
But there were six what they call flavors of quarks, right?
Yes, it's called the chromodynamics. Does anyone have any questions about the meaning of life? The meaning of life is to live, right?
Jesus is the answer
to what question?
The Cubs winning the World Series.
There you go. Thanks for listening.
All right, Doug, are you ready? We got another rebutter.
The other book I brought by was a more modern book written by Lawrence Krauss. He sometimes is on those programs that Charlie was talking about on the cable TV. Because I'm tired a lot, I sometimes doze off watching them. But they do talk about this stuff on Discovery Channel, History Channel. History Channel is a program called The Universe, and they had a bunch of programs about this kind of stuff. And Krauss is on them. Science Channel 2, universe from nothing. So that's the big question, isn't it? If the universe did come from a prior universe, or I'm not sure about it. I know what you're talking about, Joe, so I'm going to have to look into that. One universe at a time. Of course, we have the time parameter of our universe, but the other universes would have their own time parameters, so they should be able to exist, independently of ours. And indeed, that theory that we were both talking about—you mentioned it too—the theory that there might be universes in a multidimensional hyperspace that would be separated by small distances in that hyperspace, and that the Big Bang wouldn't then be an explosion, as it were. It would be the result of the energy caused by the disruption of the two universal membranes colliding together, which would happen quantum mechanically, because as the 1, 2, 3 infinity author George Gamow pointed out, if you have enough monkeys typing long enough, they would come up with the works of Shakespeare. So if you have enough universes just vibrating, they're going to hit each other once in a while. But then, I never understood that theory completely anyway, because if you had a time parameter in our universe, might stretch back infinitely, and then, at time t equals zero, arbitrarily taken, but you could have a negative infinity time going back, that would be the time where the Big Bang occurred, when the two universes collided, ours and one that's twilight zone apart from us. And that would cause the Big Bang explosion going in a forward time direction, but the t equals zero is just arbitrary, and you still could go back infinitely in time. Now that's, that might be a quantum mechanical thing that's, you know, it might be allowed to have an infinite time going backwards because you can never get to it, so you could never prove a beginning. And I've often thought about that, weird things like that at night. This idea that there's a dark energy field, if it has properties other than simply being an energy density of space, which could be quantum mechanically of an origin of quantum mechanical nature, that's been speculated upon. But of course, the old story is that it's been a story for a good while, that when somebody started calculating the amplitudes of all of the virtual particles that ought to exist in a given volume of space and found out it should be something like 10 to the 120th energy density. Unless you have supersymmetry, then you would just arbitrarily say that the energy density would be negative for the supersymmetric particles. Oh, but then are they all going to add up to just the small, it's a very small amount of, by the way folks, it's a small amount of dark energy in each volume of space. It's very small and almost indetectable, but it's detectable with the influences that it has at long distances on that graph that that the speaker put up. So it's not enough energy to fuel the sun or anything like that, but it is enough energy with a negative pressure, that's another thing that's weird about it, to push the galaxies apart. And the reason why we don't notice it here is that we have very strong forces, extremely strong, much stronger than the force that's creating space and pushing space apart. Much stronger forces are holding our bodies and the atoms of the podium and everything together. So that's why we don't notice it in this room or even in the solar system. I see that my friend wants to speak, so I will.
The only thing I want to say tonight is that, you know, a lot of us get our first exposure to this stuff by reading some of the great works of science fiction, particularly those works by Isaac Asimov, somewhat by in there. I had just basically finished up myself the Foundation trilogy, which was the Rise and Fall and Rise Again of a Galactic Empire. And it brought into many things in there, particularly one little device they called the SpeakWrite, where you spoke into a machine and wrote a Cyrillic script. Well, we've got that today, called Word and with other software products, you can do that. It is amazing, though, what we have seen just in the brief short years since the publication of the masterwork of the Foundation Trilogy in 1951. And if any of you have not read a good science fiction book lately or have read one in the past, I would strongly encourage you to read it again because it does open up a world of maybe the thinking you had as a kid. It sometimes needs to be reawakened a little bit. And the science of cosmology, it's brought out a lot in me too. Yeah. Thanks, thank our speaker again, and if you're ready to rebut us and get the last word in, let's get going.
Thank you, Vincent. No problem.
Speaker gets the last word.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, for your kind attention. A few remarks on rebuttals. The most interesting sounding rebuttals use math as a basis. And math, as we started out at the beginning, is not physics. Physics is not math. It's no question that we can add, subtract, multiply, divide, and create all kinds of wonderful equations to describe something. But when you look at that description alone, without any words, it tells you nothing. And so Richard Feynman said, in order to be able to describe physics with math, you have to have a very good basis of physics. Unfortunately, most of the mathematicians do not understand that, and they think just because the equations look so gorgeous, it explains physics, and it does not. Thank you for your attention.
All right, tell us again about your book and where we can get it.
Right here.
You can get your book right here. $9.95 plus a nickel tax.
Is it available on Amazon? Or?
Oh, yes, it's available at Amazon.com, and you can preview the introduction and the chapter titles at Amazon.
Speaker?
Okay.
And so all you do is look at the Big Bang book by Sven.
Here.
Okay. It's $9.95 at Amazon, and you need to pay the tax and shipping. So you can get it from me for $10. So.
Yes,
and I'll be happy to sign it for you.
Oh,
I want to be
better. So, Joe, when are you going to die?
Yeah.
I got to check this
out.
One sale.
Can't be any worse than some books I've read.
You're going to go this way.
That's a call, America.
And that's our college.
Come in this way.